So it's very nice to have Dr. James Best back with us again this afternoon to have a bit of a chat. Hi, James. How are you?
Hi, Nicole. Very well, thank you. Thanks for having us along again.
Well, look, I know we had a chat a few weeks ago, but that seems like 10 years ago.
A millennium ago, yeah.
In COVID land. I think the first time I spoke to you, we were talking about, you know, some of the medical facts around COVID and how that might relate to our autism community. Whereas today, I want to ask you about those kind of medical facts as well, but a little bit in relation to the fact that I'm hearing, or the topic I'm hearing most about, is kids going back to school. So we had kids coming off school, lots of confusion, lots of routines being thrown out, lots of parents enjoying homeschooling. And then all of a sudden now they're being ready or not. And now the kids are going back to school. What I'm hearing from a lot of parents is, should I be sending my kid back to school? Is it different for kids with autism? Where do we sit with this? And you don't have any kids at school anymore, so I can't ask you that question, but would you send your kids to school if you were young enough to have them? But of course, your advanced age, you don't.
I most certainly would. It's been a really big change, and it's also then been a really big change back. And when you're dealing with people with autism, or people dealing with people with autism, change is hard. And so this has been a very difficult couple of months for everybody, of course, but it's been particularly difficult for, I think, for people with autism and their families because of that change aspect. The whole world's been disrupted massively, and now we're disrupting back the other way. So I think for very different reasons in the last month compared to prior to that, and as you say, it seems so long ago, we've had this series of changes happening. And it's had flow-on effects that we didn't really expect. And that's led to the pathway that we've taken in terms of coming off school and then going back.
Yeah, but I mean, okay, let me ask specifically the question. Would you send Sam, your son with autism, if he was still of school age, would you send Sam back? Because I think there's a rule for all kids and maybe is it different for ours?
Look, I would send Sam back. I would, absolutely. The thing about it, people often think with autism that autistic people don't want socialization, and that's nearly always, that is not the case. Actually, they want and need more socialization, and the little bit of socialization they have is actually quite precious to them. So to have that taken away by distancing themselves from social contact in school is actually, a lot of the time, is quite traumatic, and that's certainly what I've seen in my patients on the spectrum. And it's been very difficult for them, not only the change, but also that little sort of tiny connection that they did have, that was taken away. And so also their anxiety, and which is so common in autism, about the whole coronavirus thing and being sick or giving it to grandma or whatever, that has massively ballooned. And so now we have this whole new set of worries, and I've got literally dozens of families that I've been talking to, and including some of the interactions I've had with paediatricians and child psychiatrists, where there's been an absolute explosion in mental health problems, particularly anxiety, and also things like OCD and oppositional defiance. And there's been a real flare up in behaviours with the whole home experience. And I think getting them back to school is important, because we need to get them moving forward again if we can.
Well, here's a question then just about the health aspects of it, because I was driving past my local high school, which is different than little kids, I get it, yesterday afternoon at 3:30, and it was like the opposite of social distancing. It was kind of teenagers walking in packs and
like they always do. So you see these teenagers and people in their 20s, you know, they just seemed oblivious to the whole social distancing message, and that's even been talked about at a political level. But for all that, the reason why we are still doing what we are doing, where we're saying open up schools again, is because of the actual medical aspects of coronavirus have been overtaken by the mental health aspects of coronavirus, and massively so, actually. There are really worrying trends in terms of people trying to access emergency mental health services and all that. So the actual virus thing, and from a public health point of view, where we have this situation now where we've got very little coronavirus in the country, and we also have lots and lots of testing. We have 10,000 tests a day, And so it's almost like a giant game of whack-a-mole, where you got some little outcrop of coronavirus in a school in the eastern suburbs of Sydney, and whack, we do it with a whole lot of testing and we shut it all down, and then we wait for the next one. And so that's kind of the approach, which actually gives us some sort of sense of control over the situation that that we didn't have before. And I think people are generally fairly bullish about the fact that we are not going to get that second wave at this time. I mean, who knows?
Yeah.
But I think our approach at the moment is fairly sensible. So the whole return to school thing, really, it's the other aspect. It's the fact that they've been at home, that they've been socially isolated, that they've got increasing anxiety, that they've got increasing mental health issues, not only the children, but also the parents as well. If they've got either mental health issues themselves or at risk of mental health issues. You've also got psychosocial stuff coming in, where we've got increased rates of domestic violence and we've got increased rates of substance abuse. We have people losing their jobs, financial stress. So this whole crockpot. So that's why go back to school is actually a very sensible message at the moment.
Yeah, good. I'm feeling better about that now. It's just in terms of the transmission that we were worried, where the virus was going to go, is really turned out to, luckily, because of all the mitigating factors that we did, has turned out to be not as much risk as the mental health side of it, which...
Yeah. See, our viral risk situation at the moment is completely different to what it was 6 weeks ago.
Yeah, okay.
6 weeks, right. We didn't know what was where.
Yeah.
Now we have a pretty good idea that if every snuffly nose in the country is swabbed within a day or two, which is kind of what we're trying to do, and that, by the way, folks, is really important, that we will find, because, kids who have milder symptoms, they might even be asymptomatic.
Yeah.
So if we get one positive, we've got to think there's probably lots more positives around that particular one. So we jump on it locally. But that's what we're doing. That's why I say that giant game of whack-a-mole. That we've got potential for little outcrops to happen. It's still around, but it's just at a very low level. And then we jump on it. So and while we're doing that, that gives us, like, basically we've got our hands on the wheel to a certain extent in terms of the virus. But the ripple effect that's happened because of what we've had to do is now really our focus.
Yeah, and I think we're going to be talking about that for quite some time to come.
Yes, and who knows where we're going to be in another month or two. It's going to be another, and so all that uncertainty, once again, adds to it all. And also, can I just say, people who are on the spectrum, they can often have a very different perspective on what is going on. They can often have a very different understanding of what is going on. They may not really, depending on co-diagnoses, level of autism, all that sort of thing, their capacity to understand what is happening. Remember, the media is just completely saturated with messages at the moment. Some of them are quite scary. They might be listening to news about America and seeing thousands of people dying and think that they're at risk because of that, and be terrified of going back to school. So I think it's, as a really parent, we have to lead them through the process.
It's a really good point, and it's something we've had in this house, and I think it's, something...
And mine.
Yeah, and a media diet, and what we're all watching and what we're doing, and remembering, for some older kids who can access YouTube and other sources of information, it can't...
And misinformation.
And misinformation, yeah, just as much. Yeah.
A good example is the Kawasaki-like syndrome, yeah. Which people may or may not know about. There's this complication of coronavirus that does happen in children, that is similar to a disease called Kawasaki disease. It is a very rare disease where the body's immune system overreacts to a viral infection. And that can happen with coronavirus too, but it's rare.
Yeah.
And the version we've got from coronavirus overseas is actually rarer than rare. It's vanishingly rare. But for us to be worrying about that in a country that's got 500 cases active at the moment is silly. But there is still some anxiety about that. So we've got to put things into perspective.
Well, thank you for helping us do that this afternoon, Dr. Best.
My pleasure. My pleasure, Nicole.
All right. Hopefully, if we talk again in another couple of months, hopefully things will have calmed down. But we'll catch up again. Thank you for being taking the time. And
you look after yourself, and everyone out there looks after themselves as well.
Thanks, James. See ya.
Bye.